Hi, I'm Tony. Welcome to South Peoria Baptist Church. We're really glad you took the time to join us today as we continue to study and grow in God's Word.
Woo!
Yeah! All right. Now let's take a look to see what's going on around campus this week. If this is your first time visiting with us, welcome. We encourage you to fill out the connection card in our bulletin and drop it in the offering plate later in our service. We encourage everyone, visitors and members alike, to connect with us via our website, our connection card, or through our giving kiosk located right here in the lobby.
Hey everybody, Anthony here, the youth pastor at South Peoria. And here at South Peoria, we know it is not easy being a teenager. So, if you're a 7th grader all the way through 12th grade, we actually meet in this building at 6:30 on Wednesday nights, where we come together, we play games, we have a great time worshiping God through music, and most importantly, we dive into the Bible. And we get to see that God uses teenagers, that God uses people to change the world. So we'd love to see you. Once again, 6:30 Wednesday night. We'll see you guys there.
Once again, we're grateful you were able to join us today. If you have any questions, please feel free to stop by our office during our office hours or visit us at our website or Facebook or YouTube. Thank you for coming. Have a great day.
So what we want to do is just ask you about your time on the field.
Oh, I could tell stories upon stories.
Do I need to take the glasses off?
All right.
We want the uncut version.
Okay.
I thought you were going to let me think about these questions before you ask them to me.
All right, you ready? First question. When you think back on your time overseas, what brings you joy?
It's the relationships, sharing of life, the sharing of who Jesus is. The greatest joy of my time overseas definitely is people.
People.
It's the people.
People.
The people that I got to meet.
The lives that were changed.
It's the people.
It's
definitely is people that flash before my eyes when I think about joy on the field.
What's one thing you wish you had known when you first went overseas that you know now?
You really are not in control.
I'm totally dependent on God.
My best efforts would never get it done.
Just been more genuine instead of more calculating.
How integral my kids could be in ministry in a developing country that was very close to the gospel.
How much the people become your family.
That if you're not passionate about reaching lostness where you are, it's not going to grow when you go to a foreign land.
To what degree did the Lottieman Christmas offering impact your work?
There is no way we could have gone where we went without Lottie Moon.
Tires were expensive to replace. I think he had the record in Kenya, changing 60 flats in 1 year.
Wheelchairs.
Textbooks.
Housing.
Surgery.
Solar panels.
Honda 185 motorcycle. It was kids on the back of this thing, motocross all the way to church on Sunday.
Torn Achilles, shoulder surgery.
Without the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, I would be a mess.
You know, I never would have gotten to the field if it wasn't for the local church.
More than just an offering.
Every penny that was given.
Crucial, vital.
Literacy work.
Education opportunities.
A refugee center.
Health care. We put in almost 300 wells.
Trained church planters.
Strategic.
Lifeline.
Cooperative effort
for the gospel around the world.
How has serving overseas changed you?
I think no one could have told me when I moved overseas what it was like to be a minority.
More sensitive to the needs of people around me.
Rather than seeing a people group, I see people.
More attuned to God's leadership.
Ultimately confident in God.
In your opinion, what do you think church leaders could do to increase involvement overseas?
marry the legacies of the past with the challenges of the future.
Model what it means. Go yourself.
People in the church will follow the example of their church leader.
We're giving them a vision for missions, not just as something that happens when you get on an airplane, but helping them become stronger disciples of Christ in their own community.
If we're involved in global work, it will impact our local work.
He's brought the nations here.
Refugees, migrant workers.
Entrepreneurs looking for new ways to get into countries.
The opportunities really are limitless.
Last question. Being a missionary is blank.
Whew. Just being who you are as a Christian.
A calling? It's something that Jesus has asked all of us to do.
It's making disciples.
A challenge.
An exciting adventure.
It didn't look anything like I thought it was going to look.
Waking up every day and asking, where is the Father at work and what would he have me do?
To live out my life for Jesus in front of other people, no matter where I live.
There's nothing like it. Nothing.
Expectation. Christmas is coming. Go ahead. Tell me to calm down. I can't. There's so much visiting, going, shopping, dropping everything to make sure your loved ones have the right gift, the perfect gift. Shh. Listen to the silence. There's anticipation. There's excitement. I can't wait for Christmas because Christmas is coming. Maybe it's not even the day, but it's the sensation during this preparation, it's all this anticipation that Christmas is coming. We rejoice and thank God that the shepherds saw the angels that night. Behold, they brought good news of great joy for the people of the world. Wise men brought gifts to the one who was, a gift to all mankind, the first Christmas gift, the perfect gift. When Jesus the King came the first time, he did not appear on a throne or a high seat. He came as a baby and slept his first night in a place where animals eat. Christmas is coming. No, Christmas is here. The Messiah came down, God in the flesh, yet the world treated him as something less. No, no, you didn't hear me. Christmas is coming. Our King is coming. The first Advent, the first time he came, he took the sins of many. He paid our price, our King, our perfect sacrifice. Hebrews 9:28 states he will appear a second time to rescue those who are waiting. I told you, Christmas is coming. This time, it will not be in a manger. There will be no nativity. We will see our King in all his divinity. He will rescue us from the chaos of the present of the now. But let us look forward to that second coming. Thank you, Jesus, for the gift of expectancy. Christmas is coming. Jesus is coming.
Thank you, David. Good morning. How is everyone today? Merry Christmas! Wow, we're going to have all the kids come and join us right up here in the front. All right, and sit right here. Okay.
Oh, that's a great trip.
Oh, look at all these kids.
Just waiting for Chloe to get tripped.
Oh, I know. Okay, Chloe, won't you come and sit beside me for a moment? Okay. Here we go.
We got a rope.
Janai, would you like to help me this time? Okay. Wonderful. Won't you come here? Fantastic. All right. What a great group of kids. For the Sundays leading up to Christmas, even Christmas Day, Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, we're going to include a time for our kids in our worship services. They're going to join us today. We're going to be lighting a candle over there, and it's called the Candle of Expectancy as we deal with Advent. And I've got some scripture Bible verses that we want to read today. And so, Janiah, if you could read the first two paragraphs for us, please.
And because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea. David's ancient home, he traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, who was engaged to, who was now expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no lodging available for them.
The shepherds and angels. That night there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified, but the angel reassured them. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. And you will recognize him by the sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth lying in a manger." Suddenly, the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased."
Thank you, Janaya and Chloe. I am excited. Christmas is coming. How many of you have already told Mom and Dad what you want for Christmas? You told your brother what you want for Christmas, okay. Okay, Grandma and Santa, okay, in that order, okay. That's good, especially Grandma. Let Grandma know. Yeah? You told your mommy what you want for Christmas. Who did you tell? You told your brother what you want for Christmas. That's good. But I think you should tell your daddy, too. Yeah. You know what? I love Christmas. All of my life, I've loved Christmas. I love Christmas morning. I love the food. I love the music. And I love getting presents when I was a kid. Sometimes my folks would put the presents under the Christmas tree, like 2 or 3 weeks, and I'd come and I would rattle it, I'd shake it, and I would almost break it, and I'd wonder, what is it? And I would have great, and I'll use this big word, expectation. I would be so excited for Christmas morning to come, expecting something special in that box. Wow! And then I grew up, and I had kids of my own. And you know what? My expectation changed from getting a gift to giving a gift. And now I have great anticipation of what it's going to be like when someone opens the present I give to them, that I picked out just for them. Not too long ago, my oldest son gave our middle son a birthday present, and he was so excited. He told everybody what the present was except for his brother. And we all gathered with cameras ready in anticipation of him opening that present. And when he opened it up and his eyes got big, he says, "What is this?" We all started laughing and taking pictures because we were anticipating his response to the present his brother had given to him. Well, it's not just in giving and receiving presents that we have anticipation or expectation, but often it's when we have a baby that comes to our family. This is little Ellie. Hi, Ellie. Can you guys all say hi to Ellie? Yes, and how old is Ellie?
She's
4 months old. Well, this is Billy and Mia and baby Ellie. And it wasn't that long ago that Billy and Mia had great expectation because they were about to have a baby. Billy, tell us about it.
I remember sitting there getting ready, and I'd say about a month left before Ellie was due. I'm sitting there like, oh, we're going to be late, the nursery's not done, nothing's ready. And I get terrified when I'm late, so, all right, we ended up taking a day where we're going to get it all done. And we ended up getting it all done in about a day. And once we got it done, I remember sitting there, we're like, God, all right, we're done, we're ready. We've got 3 weeks or so left, so we're good to go. Next day, here comes Ellie. So much for 3 weeks.
When we found out that we were going to have a baby girl, we were so excited. We had all this joy, and we just wanted to know what she was going to be like, what she was going to grow up to be like, what was she going to look like. And here she is, just a bundle of joy. So we really loved just being able to anticipate her coming and be expectant for her.
I wonder if Mary and Joseph had that kind of anticipation, too. An expectation is they were on their way to Bethlehem. Wondered what the baby would look like. Would he cry a lot? What would he look like? What would he be like? I think that Mary and Joseph had great expectations, anticipation. They were so excited. That was a very unusual kind of birth. Not very many babies are born in stables. Usually they're in a home or in a hospital kind of setting. But Jesus was born that night with great expectations. Miss Michelle, can you light the candle over there of expectations for us. Because God has given to you and I that wonderful gift of expectation. Our air conditioner may not let it continue to burn, but we'll see if we can light it. We may have too much of a breeze over here. Yeah. There we go. The candle of expectation. That's one of the emotions that God has given to us, like happiness, sadness, anger. I really like the gift of expectation. And as we move towards Christmas, it's a special gift. Well, you know, not too long ago, we filled these boxes up, didn't we? And sent them to places around the world. In fact, Billy and Mia and Miss Michelle and her husband and son, they went to California and worked at a huge warehouse putting these boxes that you made together in bigger boxes over there. I wonder, when this box arrives in a church, maybe in the Philippines or in Africa, do you think the kids there will have great expectations, anticipations? I think so. I think they will hardly be able to wait to open it. As they get the box, and then they go sit down, and then the pastor will say, okay, everybody open the box. And inside there will be dolls or cars or pencils or little pieces of bread, not bread, but of toothpaste or different things that are in there. So much excitement. Well, in anticipation day, I have a gift for you today. And I want to thank you all for being so good today. So, if you'll stand with me, please. And you come by and you can grab a piece of one of these candy canes. And thank you so much. A candy cane again. Okay. I bet you're going to get a lot of candy canes this Christmas. You have a whole tree full of candy canes. I'm going to come to your house. No. They're all for you. Okay. All right. Okay, you can follow Miss Michelle. Thank you all so much. Yes, give him a hand, please. All right, there you go. There you go. Would you pray with me, please? Father, I thank you for the gift of expectation. All the wonderful emotions you've given to us, love, grace, anger, happiness, and joy. Lord, one of those gifts is the gift of expectation, anticipation, being able to look forward to something with great expectation. And Lord, we look forward to the day we can see you face to face. In Jesus' name, amen.
This is a gift for the whole family. You see, we are a Christmas decorations right after Thanksgiving dinner type of family. As soon as the stuffing is in the Tupperware, boom, we are sending out ornaments and lights. And truth be told, the lights stay out till mid-January at a minimum. Now, that may be because we just love the Christmas atmosphere and the Christmas spirit, or we're just lazy. I mean, we were devoted to the tradition of it, to the routine of it. I think in our hearts we just got lazy. We have this tradition where every Christmas we would all set up a nativity scene, and we'd set it out diligently, routinely. It was almost as if we were just trying to get through that next hurdle so we could watch our Christmas movies. So I had this idea. That's right. I stole baby Jesus. I plucked him right out of there. I started doing this about 4 years ago. I wanted him to mean something when he was in the manger. Now I know what you're thinking. What? Why would a sane man hide the baby Jesus during Christmas? And I think therein lies the problem. A, I'm not that sane. And B, for me, Jesus was becoming just another ornament. And I just didn't want him to be that anymore. I wish you could have been there that very first year. It was bedlam. The mystery of baby Jesus' whereabouts was on the forefront of everyone's minds. And then before you know it, I started throwing out these little ransom notes. And then people were, they were searching for clues. And every night at dinner table, they would come up with these new theories.
In the kitchen. I think he's somewhere outside. I think he's somewhere in the living room.
For 3 weeks straight, our house was cloaked in conspiracy.
I wonder where he is.
Me too.
Now, I may not be the brightest bulb on the Christmas tree, but I do know, and I was raised to know, that the most important thing about Christmas is to seek Christ. And that's why I hide the baby Jesus. My kids, they've gotten so into this. 2 years ago, they made shirts that said, keep calm and find Jesus. And last year they made a Facebook and they posted everything on it. You want to know where I hid baby Jesus this year? I hid him in our flower bed.
Yep, gave him a little ransom note. Their last clue was this, Ephesians 5:2.
And walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. The fragrant offering part kind of confused my little one. She kept trying to look for him in the bathroom. Anyway, it took them a while, but they finally found him. I still got it. So, I have to go back out and hide him again. Because we will not open this gift until Christmas Eve. And then on Christmas Eve, we'll turn off the phones and the TVs. And I'll just be quiet. He came into the world quietly. And I just want my family to absorb this. And then we will open up this gift, this amazing, God-breathed, prophecy-filled gift. And we will sit around as a family, and we will talk about why Jesus was the greatest Christmas gift ever.
Christmas already? Wow, I sang Christmas, Merry Christmas to people as they came in this morning. Some of you looked at me like I was crazy. Like, it's not Christmas yet. Today is December 4th. I can't believe it is already December and Christmas is here. Well, we're starting our Christmas series, which is called The Gifts of Christmas. And the very first gift that we're looking at is called The Gift of Expectancy. And to expect Jesus to show up. And I'm excited about that. But before we continue on, I just want to draw your attention to the bulletin you should have received when you came in today. If you're a guest with us, I want to draw your attention to the very front of this. If you open it up, there's a communication card there. Please fill that out. We'd love to connect with you. Drop that in an offering plate later on in the service. And then if you flip that over, there's a prayer card on the back. And our staff tries to meet every day of the week in order to pray over the prayer needs of our church. And we would love to pray for you. So please drop that in an offering plate later in the service. Well, as we continue on expectancy, I'm excited about our Christmas season as we begin to unwrap gifts each week. As we unwrap this gift of expectancy this week, next week's the gift of grace, and then the gift of adoption, and then last, the gift of reconciliation. On our Christmas weekend, just to give you an idea of what that looks like, Christmas falls on a Sunday this year, so Christmas Eve services on Saturday night at 4 o'clock and 5:30, and then Sunday morning we're going to have, I believe it's a 9 a.m. service, and there's just going to be one service on Sunday. It will be the same service that happens on Christmas Eve. So we're just asking you to pick either a Christmas Eve service or a Christmas morning service and come to that as we unwrap the final gift of Christmas. Well, man, I can't believe it's already Christmas and all the things that happen with Christmas. I think if you look back to the summertime, I think it was July 5th when you could turn the radio on and hear Christmas music. Or maybe in the stores, you saw the Christmas stuff come out even before Halloween or anything else came out. And so this, I don't know if it's in your house or not, but in my house, I just can't do Christmas music before Thanksgiving. If you turn the radio on, did you hear Christmas music before Thanksgiving? Our kids, our family loves Christmas music. We could do Christmas year round, but the Christmas music, I just can't do it. And our kids, the week of Thanksgiving, like, can you turn on the Christmas radio station? So I tried and I had to turn it off because I can't do Christmas before Thanksgiving. So Thanksgiving we had, it was great, and then the day after Thanksgiving we woke up to go up north and cut down a tree, and we got in the car early in the morning, and the kids were like, can we listen to Christmas music now? I'm like, now. Now we can listen to Christmas music. Now it's time for Christmas music. And you don't want just Christmas just to be something that happens, or just another ornament, or just another process that happens, just like the dad in this video. And so as we look at Christmas, we need to understand it in the context of expectancy. Over 2,000 years ago, the very first Christmas happened. And there's so much expectancy. Pastor talked about it earlier with Billy and Mia and the baby. In fact, you know what? I totally missed it, but today where'd they go? Oh, she's in the cry room over there. We have a baby in church for the very first time today. And they don't know we're talking about them. Or maybe they do. Wait, there they are. Oh, it looks like they're changing the baby. That's little Miss Gracie May. And we'll show you her in a little bit here. But you've been praying for her. Thank you for praying for her. And she is beautiful. But expectancy around pregnancy is huge. And that first Christmas, could you imagine walking across the country, being ready to have a baby, showing up in a town that's not your home, nowhere to stay, and being placed in a stable. Now, many of you grew up on a farm, many of you know of, been to a farm, or you've been into a barn, at least, or a stable, and you realize that's not the best place to be. There's so much going on in a stable, so many smells and hair and fur and the other things that happen in stables that are not pretty, right? In fact, if you work on the farm, one of the worst jobs is to muck out a stall that's in a stable, right? And so all of a sudden we see the Savior of the world being born in the most humble of places, the most inconvenient of places, and the Savior being laid in a manger where animals eat. And we look at this and this expectancy of what's going on around this baby being born. The world was looking for a Messiah, a Savior to come and conquer the world and save its people. And the Messiah shows up in the form of a humble child. And it's interesting as we look at this. I actually want us to read the Christmas story. But before we read the Christmas story this morning, I want to share with you a verse out of Philippians. And Paul wrote this. And it really, while it's not specifically about Christmas, it is exactly specifically about Christmas. He didn't write this in the context of Christmas. He wrote this in the context of understanding Christ's mind as he stepped down into his own creation. And this is what it says in Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 through 8. It says, who being in very nature, it's talking about how Jesus is actually in the mind of Jesus, how he thought. So this is Jesus' mind. Who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing, took his qualities of God and poured them out to become nothing by taking on the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. That is the very soul of Christmas. God humbled himself and made himself a servant, coming in the very appearance of man, the very nature of man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. That very first Christmas was so much of the world expecting Messiah, a baby being born, and the expectation being built around that. Jesus stepped down into his own creation, and we see in his mind a humble servant in the place that we would never ourselves want to take our own children. And that is Jesus' servant and humbleness.
And so as we read the Christmas story, we're going to turn to Luke chapter 2 in our Bibles. We're going to read verses 1 through 20. So if you'll go ahead and turn in our Bibles to Luke chapter 2. And please stand with me as we go to God's Word and read the Christmas story. The children did a great job, Hollywood. Could you see the faces of the future on stage? Are we not a blessed church? Amen, amen. Let's read this. They read part of the story. We're going to read verses 1 through 20 today. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone who went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, to the town of David, because he belonged to the house of the line of David. And he went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared, and with the angel praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angel had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Let's pray. Heavenly Father God, we come into your house today, beginning to look back over 2,000 years with an expectancy of Jesus coming, and to know that expectancy still lives in our lives today. So God, we pray that as your word sits in our hearts today, God, may your spirit work and draw us closer to you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Wow. So we see this baby being born, Jesus, God himself, stepping down into his own creation. And we know that in the moment that a child is born between a father and a mother, as they bring this family together, that is a very beautiful time, right? A very intimate time. But as soon as Jesus was born, we found that something began to happen that would interrupt this intimate night. The most of holies of scavenger hunts was ready to begin. Out in the field were shepherds. And the shepherds lived out in the fields. They did not have homes they called their own. They didn't live in the cities or the towns. They were basically the low part of society because they lived with the animals and took care of animals. And all of a sudden, out in the darkness of the countryside, the shepherds are sitting there with their sheep, and an angel appears and says, "Do not be afraid," right? "For I bring you good news of great joy that will bring joy to all the people. Do not be afraid, for today a Savior is born to you." And then this angel gives them the clues to one of the greatest scavenger hunts of all times that rings true then and rings true now to you and I, how to find Jesus. And the angel says he's going to be wrapped in cloths, lying in what? Where was he laid? In a manger. Right? That's not a clue to a palace. It's not even a clue to a comfortable home. These shepherds would have been familiar with the manger. And the angels appeared to him and said, "Look, the Savior has been born to you today for all people. Go find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes." Not in Tommy Hilfiger, but just what they've got available, wrapped around this baby, placed in a manger. And the shepherds all of a sudden saw the heavens open up, and probably one of the most frightening sights to ever be seen, with the heavenly angels all declaring together, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those whom his favor rests." And then they were gone in a blink of an eye.
And all of a sudden, the shepherds had an expectation to find the Savior. The clues have been given, so they run and they find Jesus wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger, interrupting that intimate night between Mary and Joseph. And here we find a very important point. And that's that God the Father arranges, God our good Father arranges for the gift of His Son Jesus, the great and perfect gift, to be found by all those who seek Him. It's already been prearranged that for those who seek Jesus, they will find Him. And just as those shepherds stood on that hillside that night, the clues had been given to the treasure hunt of all eternity, and the shepherds on that night decided it was not enough to stay there. They had the expectation they were going to find Jesus. And so God has prearranged it already for all of us, that for those of us who seek Christ, we can expect to find Him. In fact, in the Old Testament, the prophet Jeremiah writes to the Israelites who have been exiled and are in Babylon in captivity, and he writes to them a very popular verse many of us may have memorized. It's Jeremiah 29:11, and it says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you." And then verse 13, which I think is the most important verse of this whole thing, is this: "And you will seek me, and you will find me when you seek me with all of your heart." We can be expected to find our Savior, the Messiah, when we seek Him with all of our hearts. And that's amazing to me, because seeking the expectation of knowing, we don't even have the right to expect to know the Creator, that He would, who is man that God would even consider us? But God, from the very beginning, gave us and arranged for us the ability, the perfect gift in that moment to receive Christ in the creation. Step down and humble Himself. And we now, not just for the shepherds then, remember it says, the angel said, we bring you good news of great joy that will be for who? All the people. So it's not just for them 2,000 years ago. Not just for the shepherds on the hillside, but for all of us today, everybody in creation, everybody in our world, if they see Jesus with all their heart, they can expect to find Him. And this is a perfect gift, a great gift. In fact, this was a gift from God. You see, God desires for His people to seek and find and experience the full measure of His good and perfect gifts. I'm going to say that again. God desires for His people, each one of us, to seek, find, and experience the full measure of His good and perfect gifts. God's our perfect Father, and He gave us the perfect gift in Jesus on that very first Christmas, and He wants all of us to experience that perfect gift. A while ago, we saw a gift given out to children, and that brings joy to their eyes, and it brings joy to our hearts when we see the joy in children's eyes, right? Maybe when you were a child, or maybe you played this game with a child, you played that game where you hold a piece of candy in one hand, and you make two fists, and you put them behind your back, and you mix it around, and you ask them to pick a piece of candy, and or pick a hand, and then you show them whether the candy's there or not. We've all played that, right? But the whole point of that game, is to give the child the candy, to see the surprise, for them to get what they're expecting. What kind of person would you be if you put that piece of candy in your pocket and stood there for 5 minutes, and the kid picked the hand each time, and there was never candy? And then he said, "See, life's full of disappointments," and walked away. What kind of person would you be, right? Think about that. That's not the point of the game. The point of the game is to give the child the candy and to see the expectation met. And that's how God treats every single one of us. When we come to God, He wants to give us. He's the giver of all good and perfect gifts, and He wants to give to us freely. In fact, James chapter 1, verse 17 says this: "Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the heavenly Father, from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows." Every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of heavenly lights. This is a title. This is an endearment for God the Father. The Jews use this to actually express their love for God the Father by calling Him the Father of heavenly lights, because it credits Him back to creation, the very beginning. He's the one who created the light and the darkness. He's the one who hung the sun and the moon and the stars in place. And every day, the heavenly lights reminded them of their Creator, the Father of heavenly lights, who from day one, the Creator, would give out good and perfect gifts, accumulating up to the perfectness of Jesus and handing Jesus to His creation as salvation. It's a beautiful picture that God wants all of us. Our good and great Father wants to give us the things that we need. In fact, Matthew, Jesus tells us in Matthew, He says, "Which of you, if your son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask Him?" We know how to give good gifts to our children, and our God is so much more righteous, so much more good than we are. How much more does He want to give us as the Father gives the expectation to know that His gifts, we know that God's gifts are given to us, and we can expect them because He loves us and gave us the greatest gift of all in Jesus. And it tells us in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish but have eternal life." But it goes on in verse 17, it says, "For God did not send His Son into the world to," say it, "condemn." I'm going to read that again. "For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to," say it, save the world through Him. The gift of eternal life through Christ Himself. That's powerful. So we know that because we have sought God out with all of our heart, and we can expect Him to give us those gifts because He's already given us the gifts, that we can always expect God to show up. We can expect God to always show up in our lives. And how do we expect that? When the angel appeared to Mary and Joseph, He says, "You shall call His name Emmanuel," which means God with us. His name is Emmanuel, which means, say it, God with us, which means we can expect God to always be there. When it's bad and chaotic, we can expect God to show up because He's already there. When it's good and joyful, we can expect God to show up because He's already there. He has given us a gift of expectancy because we have already seen how good God is, and He will always be with us. So we can look forward with expectancy, knowing how God good is, and that He will always be there, and that He is coming back for us. One of the biggest parts of expectancy for me as a child when we're getting ready for Christmas seemed to always be centered around pulling out the nativity scene. And I remember this nativity set that we had. It was like a porcelain nativity set that my mom had hand painted, right? It was beautiful. And so I remember every Christmas, it seemed like Christmas started when that nativity set was pulled out. And if your nativity sets were anything like the nativity set that I'm talking about, we couldn't keep our hands off of it as kids, right? And so this beautiful porcelain nativity set, over time, began to, you know, maybe a shepherd was missing a staff, or a cow went completely, or an oxen went completely missing. Maybe Jesus maybe had a chipped head, and then maybe a hand was falling off the shepherd, you know? Like, it began to wear and tear over time, because it was very precious and very fragile, but we just couldn't, I loved setting it up. I couldn't help but touch it, right? And as you sit here today, I think it is a beautiful representation of the Nativity, but it may be a poor representation of Jesus. And this is why, this is a true story. There was a lady who was in charge of a child, a preschool, a Christian preschool. And she went out and she bought a stuffed Jesus. Now that sounds weird, but basically a Jesus version of a teddy bear. And so pretty quickly in this preschool, this stuffed Jesus became the favorite toy among the children. And as controversial as that sounds, it was. And so some of the parents began to complain. You know, "I don't think that's appropriate. I don't think that's right. That's not." And so it seemed like every parent that came, they would voice their complaint, and then she would answer them, and they would walk away pleased and excited that Jesus was there. And so one of her workers came and says, what do you tell them? She says, well, they come in and I understand what they're saying, that this may not be the appropriate way to look at Jesus. So I asked them as a parent, which Jesus do you want your children to know? The one that's always with them? The one that always brings comfort? Or the porcelain one up on the shelf that they can never touch? There's an expectancy that comes with knowing the real Jesus. There's an expectancy of knowing he's always there. And so looking back at the first Advent, Advent means arrival, the very first coming of Jesus. Looking back at the first Advent of Jesus gives us an expectancy of the future Advent of our coming King. That if we know God will always be there, we can look back to the first Advent as a point in history that points us to the future of our coming King. In fact, Revelation talks about that and describes what our King's going to look like when he returns. And I want to read that to you. I want to read that to you. It says this. John writes as he saw the coming of Jesus. He says, I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and wages war, and his name is the Word of God. And on his robe and on his thigh, he has this name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The humble Advent that we look back to is a beautiful picture of God's grace and love and the nativity scene. But as David said earlier, there will not be a nativity again. For as we look forward, our expectation is the coming of our King. And on his robe and on his thigh, he's written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Sometimes, in the goings and comings and all the distractions of our world in Christmas, we place our expectations in the wrong things, and our expectation of Jesus disappears. I talked about that Christmas music earlier, and there's a Christmas station we listen to. And I realized this week as we were preparing for this idea of expectation, I began to really listen to the Christmas music, and I realized the Christmas music we were listening to all day long, there was no Jesus. It was beautiful Christmas music that pulled on the strings of my heart, and it was like, we wish you a Merry Christmas, or all I want for Christmas is you. And you know all these songs, right? And I realized there's no Jesus. And so I went online, and you can go to, most radio stations have a playlist of the songs that they play. So I began to look at the songs that our Christmas station plays, trying to find Jesus, and I found one. Joy to the World. It doesn't get more Jesus than that, right? Joy to the World, our Lord has come. So I pulled it up, and it was an instrumental. No words. And I thought to myself, I didn't even see it. And my expectation of Christmas had been this alive. And I have a story I want to share. I asked permission to share this story because it's of our family. So I asked my wife, it's all right. And she told me it is. So I'm going to share it with you. But no, it's really okay. She's laughing. So my wife, I'm a blessed man. I have a beautiful wife, and she is probably one of the best gift givers of all time. See, for me, one of the best things you can do for a gift, I love expectancy so much, is to wrap a present and put it under the Christmas tree the day after Thanksgiving. Because if I can see it, I love, the expectation of the gift makes the gift for me. I love expectancy. And she's on the opposite side of the spectrum for me. She loves surprises. She doesn't want to look forward to it. She just wants to be surprised. In fact, the best thing I could do for her is pretend like I bought her nothing and then just show up and give her a gift. She loves the surprise. I want to see what you bought and expect it to be open, you know? I love the expectancy. Anticipation is the gift for me. And she is so good at balancing both of those things for us. And she usually does a really good job of just blessing me with the gift of, wow, I can't believe you got that for me. And the expectancy of seeing, I mean, she does a great job. Last year, time got away from us. And so we're just like a week and a half out from Christmas, and we haven't bought our gifts for each other yet. So she set aside a special day. She said, I'm going to go buy your present today. I'm like, okay, go ahead. So she left that morning, and she went Christmas shopping. And a couple hours goes by, and I haven't heard from her. So I call her. I'm like, are you okay? She's like, yeah, I'm just trying to narrow it down. I'm working on this. I just want it to be perfect. Okay. Starting to build expectancy, because I love expectancy. A few more hours go by, and I'm thinking, I still haven't heard from her. Lunch is almost here. Are you okay? She's like, yeah, I'm not going to be home for lunch, but I have to do the kids. I'm just going to make it. It's got to be right. Okay. Soon it's dark outside, right? And it's gone all day, and I'm thinking to myself, she's got this down. She's got something planned. So I call her. She's like, I'll be home in an hour. I'm almost done. I've got this done. I'm running all over town. It's just got to be perfect. Whatever. So I'm like, all right. So she comes home for Christmas shopping and goes directly to our bedroom, wraps the present, brings it out, and puts it behind the tree because she can't put it under the tree because it's almost as big as the tree. It's huge. And I'm like, wow. And the kids walk in, and they're instantly jealous. Like, whose gift is that? Right? And so I get to look at it for a week and a half, and I'm trying to guess in my head, what is it? Because I'd asked for a watch, and this is huge. That'd be a really big watch. But so she's really good at surprises, and so she builds the expectancy, and it wouldn't be beyond her to take a huge box and put a little tiny present in it. And so all this happens, and then I'm looking forward to Christmas morning. Sometimes if you prolong things, it makes it that much better. So we have a tradition in our family that we go from youngest to oldest to open presents, so I'm the last one. And I just love that idea of holding it and waiting to open it and then finally waiting to open it. So it's time for me to open my present. And then my youngest child goes over and picks up this ginormous box and like it's nothing. And walks it over to me and lays it on my lap. So I've got this huge box that doesn't weigh anything. So I'm like, what is going on here? It's wrapped, it's huge. And so I'm excited. It's now time. The expectancy is here. So I rip into this box, rip into it, open it up, I have to stand up to open it, and I open it up and I pull out a pillow. I'm like, okay, a pillow, and I'm thinking to myself, don't look disappointed, don't ever look disappointed, what's somebody gonna give you a gift? Be kind. I think, no, this is a joke. This is a joke, she's messing with me, right? So I put the pillow aside, and I begin to dig through the rest of the box. I'm digging, digging, she's like, there's nothing else in there. Oh! It's a pillow. And she starts to cry. And she told me, here's the backside. She starts to cry. She woke up Christmas morning realizing all that expectancy, and she bought me a pillow. And I'm like, okay. I like pillows. The pillow I had, I love. I have a feather pillow. I've had it for years, and I love my pillow. I didn't need a pillow, but okay. I'm going to love this pillow because my wife bought it for me. And she's like, I didn't get you anything else. It's okay, you know? And so this idea of expecting this, she's sitting there, she's like, I'm so sorry, I ruined Christmas. But you didn't ruin Christmas. You know, you bought me what you thought was perfect, and I love it because you're perfect. And so I love you, baby. And so, you know, try to make it right. But I tell you the story. Because if we put our expectancy in the wrong place, it will lead to just disappointment. I wasn't disappointed with the pillow, I guess I won't say it. But it was on both sides, you know? And I did get the watch. She bought me the watch the next day. I was really pleased. It was great. And we got a Christmas, it was like Christmas clearance discount, so it was even better than getting it before, because I spent less of my money. But the idea behind that, she built expectancy on giving me the gift too, and I built this expectancy on getting on it. It was what neither of us had expected. And when we put our expectancy in something other than Jesus, there's nothing but disappointment. That's what our world does with Christmas. Turn on the radio station this afternoon and listen to the world's version of Christmas. And there's no Jesus. That's what they do. As soon as Christmas Eve comes around, and there's so much Christmas blues because people don't understand that even though 2,000 years ago they were looking for the Savior, the world's still looking for the Savior today, and we have him. And his name is Jesus. So the question is, what are you expecting this Christmas? Are you expecting Jesus to show up? Are you expecting to see him come? Are you expecting our Savior? In just a few moments, we're going to have a time of response. I'm going to pray. And we're going to have a time to put Jesus back at the center of Christmas with expectancy. But you may be here asking the question, how do I find Jesus? Just like those shepherds did that night. There was a holy scavenger hunt given to those shepherds.
And to be honest with you, we have the same scavenger hunt today. And how we find Jesus is very, very easy. In fact, Revelation tells us, Jesus says, here I am, I'm at the door and I'm knocking. The door of your heart and I'm knocking. And anyone that lets me in, I'll come into them. You see, when Jesus came to this world, the whole point of Christmas was for God to create a path for humanity to come back to him. And Jesus' whole point, the whole point of Christmas, was to be the price and the perfect gift to pay for your sins and for your sins. And so today, our scavenger hunt's wrapped up in what Paul says, if you believe in your mouth, believe in your heart, and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. And that leads you right back to that manger of Jesus King. And he becomes the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords of your heart and of mine. And so today, if you haven't come to the end of that scavenger hunt yet, and you haven't found Jesus, I'm going to encourage you, today is that day you need to believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. And just as the shepherds did, bow before him and rejoice, for good news and great joy have come to all the people. And so today, if that's you, in just a few moments, we're going to sing a song of response. I'm going to encourage you to come down and talk to one of our leaders, and they will walk you through that. It may be today that your family is going through chaos, which seems to happen around chaos around Christmas, and you just need prayer. I'm going to encourage you to come forward. But I'm going to encourage all of us this morning, as we have a time of response, for us to spend some time responding to God's Spirit this morning and finding out, asking God to show us how to expect Jesus in our hearts, in our lives, in our families this Christmas. Heavenly Father God, we come to you today. God, you are good. You are a good Father who gives good and perfect gifts. And we are here today to rejoice in the good news that you gave us so long ago for all the people, that for unto us a Savior has been born that takes away the sins of the world. And God, for us to place our expectation and our anticipation back on you. Looking back to that first Christmas gives us the confidence to look forward with the expectation and anticipation of our Lord coming back. So God, in this moment, I pray that your Spirit moves. God, that you work in our hearts. God, if we're here this morning, we don't know. We haven't come to the end of that scavenger hunt, but we found our King, God, and this morning is that morning. So God, we give you this time and we give you this place to work in our hearts. In your name we pray. Amen. Will you stand with us as we continue to worship? Our leaders will be down here at the front. And I encourage you, be bold and respond to what God is doing in your life.